me find up. So hi, everybody. I'm Romain. I work on Hue at Cloudera. And today I'm going to present how to build some dynamic dashboards with Solar on Hue. The goal of the presentation is to describe the latest Solar features, in particular analytics facets, as well as show how we improve the user experience with the Hue Search app, the lesson we learn, and hopefully give you some ideas if you want to build your own visualization or your own widgets on top of Solar. And before we start, is everybody familiar with Solar in the room? Anybody with Hue? Not bad. And who played with Spark already? Because I have a tiny bit. OK, really good, nice. And so feel free to maybe wait for the end for question. But if you think like it's really important, feel free to ping me too. It's cool. So to clarify everything, all the interaction made by Hue with Solar are using the Solar REST API. So Hue only needs to know the Solar host name and port, and that's it. And all of this content is based on the public API. So there is nothing magic, nothing private. It's all standard. A little bit of history on the story of the search app. So the UI on top of the Solar API. So it started 2 years ago with Hue 2. It was one HTML editor, so you could customize the results. You could put a bunch of Solar facets on the left. It looks a bit old. It was working for the time. The biggest problem was actually in the admin part, because you have a regular Solar. You can point to any Solar. And depending on your collection or index, in this case, it was Twitter data, you want to prettify it and add some facets. To add the facets, you have to know Solar pretty well. What's a facet? What's a range facet? What's a field facet? If you are doing some mistake on saving in the admin UI, you are losing all your work or your dashboard, because if you were corrupting the JavaScript or HTML, you are not seeing it before executing it on the user part. You had to know HTML and JavaScript, which was not really simple. So a lot of things to improve. So to simplify for the revamp of version 2, we try to design it in a way that the end user doesn't even know we're talking to Solar. So how we did version 2? So version 2, much sleeker. We put many more graphics. There's no more switching between another page for the admin page and the end user page. And everything is dynamic. If I show you the editor mode, it's almost the same. Just notice the top bar where you have like widgets you can drag and drop. And on each widget, you can see the little cross to remove it. And you see the extra options, like the limit on the facet, as they were not shown on the user view. So you see everything in live. You don't need to know much. And I will demo it later. And another important point, you don't even need to know what's a field facet, what's a range facet. Now you just drag and drop like a pie chart, like an histogram. And we added a lot of small widgets on user improvements. For example, now you can have like a gradient map. You can also put, like in the bottom, multiple widgets on the same fields. Anybody can create a dashboard. Before, we were saving all the content in the database. Now all the logic is in the front end. It means any user can use it because it stays on his machine. And when we save, we obviously send it to the database. But we don't need to save it to really display it. And you can exclude facets, have tree maps. We support all the latest pivot facets. And to help the user understand about his collection, you have a direct access to the statistics of each field or like top terms. So I'm going to describe the logic, how we design it. So on the right, you have the page I was just showing up with a template on the JavaScript model that will take care of putting the widgets or like all the logic of the user, all the drag and drop, for example. And for each of these actions, when I take a widget, when I click on the search button, we'll send a request to Hue. And Hue sometimes, and sometimes not, will query Solar. Obviously, query when we do a select query, but also ask for the list of fields of the collection, like look to get some values in the Solar collections. So let's now go a bit deeper and split the interface in three parts. So the first one, the layout that I just described. And now the collection. So the collection is like the list of widgets. For example, if I have a facet on like a log field or like a username or a city field, it's one of these green boxes. Then we have the query, which is like the context, the query definition of the dashboard. The query definition is, for example, when you select a facet, or on the top bar, it's like the query that the user is typing. And these two parts are split, as you're going to see why. If I take the example scenario of adding a new widget, I will drag and drop, and then pick up the list of available fields in my collection, and then query Solar. Ask Solar with look to get the minimum, the maximum, and the type of this value. And then from this type of values, we'll do a little bit of magic, like run the dates or the numbers to like, for example, something with only zeros and get a good gap. And same, the user doesn't need to know we are doing, like, for in this case, a range facets on the byte field with like 10 gaps. Everything is guessed automatically for him. When we have the query part, so all the data displayed on the green box, like all the numbers, are coming back, are sent to Solar, like with the query part one. So each of this little widget is transformed into Solar query that is described on the first on the green part. On part number two will happen when the user clicks, like for example on the face. On the row number two, we'll tell Solar, oh, the user clicked on this facet, so do a filter query on this particular range of value. We get back the JSON on the left from Solar. And to make it easier for the front-end to display it, we'll like massage it a little bit, augment it a bit. For example, instead of having some key values, like for each, we'll add a from and to. That way, the display doesn't need to do any logic and just print it. And we do it for every widget. Each widget just gets JSON data in input, and we just transform it either in text, like I just showed, or in like some other JavaScript widgets, like from gradient maps to like column or pie charts. So just think, we use it instead of text, we just send it to a mini JavaScript widget. And we repeat, and for each of these widgets, we'll see it on, like, on the main page. The biggest change recently, so Solar 5.2 was released last week, contains analytic facets. Solar search is pretty efficient because a few people knows to program, more knows SQL, but even more knows how to search, if not everybody. And with analytic facets, we can do the equivalent of SQL, all the group by and aggregations. There are two new types of facets in 5.2. First one are the cons, the functions. So you can do cons on like all your data, sum, average, percentile. There are a bunch of functions. It becomes easier to know how many unique records with this field. You can do a sum, for example, of tweets, like how many bytes, or for some logs, how many bytes in total. And you can even combine like two fields, like multiply price by quantity, and do the average of everything. By using these facets, we can build new widgets, like counter widgets or hit widgets. So you can have like the max of the sentiment of all the records, or average of bytes, or just counts. The second part are the nested facets, which are really magic. In this case, we are just counting on the left the top five operating system. Now, instead of just doing top five for everything, we can segment it, so nested it by country. So we'll get the top five operating system by country by using this syntax. We can go even deeper. By doing, instead of by country, we can also do it on a range of data. So here, I'm just taking the states, the average salary by state. Now I'm going to do it in a range facet from today to 6 months ago, and for each state by month, because the gap is a month, I will have the value, the average salary through the time. Same, all this return JSON data that we can massage and put up as a widget. This is an example with some tweets. In the previous version, we were just counting the tweets, so we have one record by tweet. It's more realistic to, instead of doing one by one, now we just sum by byte through the time. So, and you can see for the same time, the graph is not the same. Like, we have this even less records, but more traffic. So, you can apply to web logs, for example. So, it gives you another dimension on the data. And we can even do in one more dimension. If we take like the country, like country code, like Argentina, US, Brazil, we can have the bytes through the time by country. We could even drill down more and more, but then you need another type of graph. And in this app, we also support all the enterprise features. You can log in, authenticate with LDAP, SAML. Cloud or not cloud works. Because Hue is in the middle between the user and Solar, we use a proxy user, meaning Hue gives the real username of the user. That way, we have real security. And based on the latest, if you want to authorize some collection or not, it's supported through Sentry. So you can have a set of users that can see this collection or query it or not. Sorry. And some people like to use Hue only with search, and it's possible to just configure it. There's just a Hue app. And we have a list of new ways to index data. In particular, we worked more with Spark recently. And I'm going to show how we did it with just some Python, PySpark, and also with Spark streaming. To have Spark in the browser, we're using the latest Hue, which comes with the Spark notebook on the Spark server. So for the Spark users, it's a way to submit Spark jobs through a REST API. And it supports batch jobs, so you submit a jar file or Python file, or even like a shell. So you can have an interactive shell and just do REST call to submit content on display and get the result. And I will demo just after. I will demo specifically in the Spark notebook. So I'm going to switch to demo. And I'm using the latest hue on a data set from the Bay Area. So if anybody already used the bike share from San Jose to San Francisco, all the data is public from the bike traffic, all the stations. And I'm going to use this data, see how we can quickly analyze it with Solr on the latest analytics facets. So I'm just going to log in into Hue and create a new dashboard. So I can pick my layout. So just a two-column layout, no layout, or layout with some basic widgets. So I just pick a two-column layout. And now we have the grid layout, which is simpler to use than the HTML layout. And in one click, I already have like a basic search dashboard. I could exit the search mode and already search, for example, for the stations. Stations with the bike station with California in their name. In practice, users usually click on a record. That way you understand more all the fields or the index. And then you keep adding new widgets. Most famous one is just to count the number of results. So I'm just adding a hit widget that counts the unique IDs. So it's a function, the unique ID that I was showing before. If I remove the filter on search, it's going to show all my records. We can have other operation on all my data. So in this data set, we have the duration of bike trips, so a bike from this station to this other station, which is called duration and is a number. So this is a unique values, which is not useful, but we can get, for example, the average value or the mean value. So some people did a 1 minute trip, so probably take the bike, put it back. Max is impressive. I think it's 200 hours or days, forgot. So maybe a bug or something. And you have the average, but as often the median is more clear. I can just pick a few fields, like the start station, the end station, and the duration. And you can also move the fields around. And if you want to see the biggest, we are seeing it was 71,000, the highest duration. We can know which trip it was. We could get the smallest also, and like drill down a bit. We have bike data, so bike trips. So it's kind of nice to know from where they start to where. So it's easy to add the facet on the start date. So I just put the start station. I'm going to add like a map on the that takes latitude longitude of the bike station where the user is finishing. So end station lat long station ID. Up. And then just by doing this, I can see that most of my users are leaving from the Caltrain station. And if I click on the Caltrain station, it will filter all the trips and only keep the trips that comes that start from the Caltrain station. We can add another facet on the end station to visualize the map a bit better. And same, so if I just select San Francisco, most of the users that live from the Caltrain station are going to the Transbay terminal. I could select people living from market. And it will update in live, like the number of records, the median trip. It's also nice to see the distribution through the time and use analytic facets. So we can also plot to the start date of a trip. This is by week, because it's 7 days by default. I can put by week. And now we can see, if I get all the data, it will be cleaner. Here we go. We can see through the time all our trips. There is some spike of data, which are the week. And then sometimes it's a bit we have less trips than usual. So one way to do, and one way provided in the data set, is the weather data. The weather data is not in this data set, but I'm going to show how we can add all the weather data and then cross it and see if it correlates with the bike trips. For doing this, I'm going to use Spark. So the weather data is really small, like it's just by day. So I already put it on HDFS. And basically for each day, you get the temperature, mean, max, median, if it was rainy or not, the precipitation, visibility. I'm just going to clean it up a bit, because as solar user knows, to load data, index data, it needs to be clean. If not, solar won't take it. So I'm clicking in the notebook, and it's going to start a Python Spark session. And when the session becomes ready, it's going to execute the script. The script just reads the file and dumps the 10 first records. And by following this notebook, we'll prettify the data, cleanify, in a way that is like a clean CSV that can just be ingested into Solar. So we have the data. Now we're going to clean up the headers. So headers have some spaces. We're getting rid of those in this step. And then we're trying to guess the type of each column by looking at the first row of the data. And in Solar, if you add a suffix like underscore I, it means an integer, but TDD is a date or float. So we are doing it in this step. And then we just merge everything together, clean a bit, the date. Solar is really specific, so the date format. So we just parse it, clean it, and put it back. And some fields are missing, so we put a default value of 0. And that's it. That's the only real Spark line where we apply a reduce operation on all the data. I'll just show the first 100 cars. And that's it. Then we just do a post directly into the Solar with the header line, which will be the new fields. And for each field, we have the value in this CSV. So that's it. Because these are dynamic fields, I'm just saving the dashboard on refreshing, that way the field will appear in the like semi-model. And I can add like a chart. I have a bunch of new fields, all the min, max. I will use, I think it's precipitation, which is the number of the precipitation of the day. Actually, I should use the time. So I just take a graph. The date in this for the weather data is called PDT. Because we have one record by day, it's not showing up anything, because it just counts, I mean, 5 records by day. But I'm going to add a new dimension, which is the number of precipitation by day. I take the average precipitation. We see it by day, because Solar can do aggregation on this bucket of data. It's a bit more clear if I do by week. And then, it's not a big surprise, but we see where we have a big drop in our number of trips. It's related to a really rainy week in San Francisco. Other interesting data, with thanks to the analytic facets. For example, we can just guess in one click, like at what time people are doing their trips. So I'm just doing displaying. I want to take a bar chart. So this is the hour of the trip. We see most of people are taking in the morning, and then for in the afternoon. We have two types of users in this data set, which is called subscriber. Some, the customers are just customers that buy their rental bike for a day or for 3 days. The other one are subscribers, so they book a bike for 1 year, and then they pay a bit more when they use it. And we can plot these two types of users through the time. So if I plot the time of usage by the subscriber, we can see we have much more subscribers than daily users. The daily users are more towards the middle end of the day. They are not going to work early at 8. They are probably in vacation. What's interesting too, by just looking at this data, we just have counts of trips. But we can do again something smarter and have, for example, the sum of duration of trips instead of just counting the trips. So I just add the duration on top of this. Which is not working. Yeah, I need to use the sum. And it's much more different. Our daily users, most of the time, they just do a quick trip, whereas the daily subscriber, they keep their bike for the day. So it's interesting how the data can be different when we cross it with something smarter than just the counts. And so this was the bike. The last demo is more about the dataset that everybody knows. It's about Twitter data. It shows how to do real-time Twitter data analysis thanks to a search dashboard. So I already built a collection, which is a live Twitter dashboard. You can see the data, like the past day. So I just added a bit of data just before the talk on this morning. What's interesting, if we use Spark Streaming and run a Spark job, Spark can also directly send the data or index it into Solar. And it's pretty easy to use. For doing this, we're using the Spark Solar app from LucidWork, so Solar vendor. Sorry. And it's just a Spark application that I'm just starting in the shell. And all the code is linked on the slides. We improved it a little bit by adding like a little bit of sentiment scoring, just looking at the positive words, negative words, and the list of hashtags. Now if I go on the past 5 minutes, a new feature in the search dashboards is to, like, for example, auto-refresh every 3 seconds or X seconds. Sorry. And we use the same widget as before, and the graph is refreshing automatically. And we can see the live tweets appearing on the graph, the hashtags coming up. We don't have many hashtags right now. But on the map, lighting up a little bit. And right now, it's mostly the America with most of the tweets. And same as before, you could just click on the retweet tweet or not, and it will update in live all the dashboard. We need to pause the demo and go back to the slides. Thank you. So all of this is also available on demogateway.com. If people missed it or want to play with it, it's just a live demo, and you can play with your own. It's just one click, you have a free cluster for you. And what's next with the search? So analytic facets are brand new. We can use them everywhere, for example, in the pie charts. Right now, they're just on the graph bar. We can even do smarter analysis with the facets, even on the text facets. Indexing is still pretty painful to do with Solr, so we have a new app coming up where you just drag and drop a file, and it will put it a bit like the live Solr with Spark demo worked. We have more geo coming up. Think a bit like Yelp, where you can zoom in, do like little plus on the map, and we'll zoom and filter your records, or even like aggregate instead of. Right now, the marker maps is just displaying the 20 records we have. We can use a facet instead that will map, put markers based on all the data. There's a special type of facet in Solr for this. And exporting sharing dashboards. So it was doable before, but a bit clunky. Now you do it directly from the UI in the latest version. And even later, there is like really smart Solr features, Solr join. You can join, like filter out result based on the query of another collection. It's not simple to use, but we can integrate it. And we have even more Spark. So I'll show the Spark in the command line, but you'll be able to do it in the demo. So you can index tweets, whatever, even the back data as an API. As a feed of every minute, you get the number of available docs. So it was not pretty to display, so I don't use this one. I use the tweets instead, but give you the ideas. And and that's it. So thank you, everybody, for watching. If you have any question, feel free to ask them now, or offline, or after the talk, or whenever you want. Thanks.
Hue comes bundled with CDH, right?
So Hue is shipped in all the major distributions, okay. Even from Mapr to HDP to Pivotal. The version might differ a bit, might be older or a bit less complete. But it's open source, it's on GitHub. The latest is often on CDH, but some vendors, some are pretty good. But it's open source.
OK. Solr comes bundled with CDH, is that right?
There's a component in CDH, Solr Search. Okay. It's also bundled in CDH. But here, I was using Nightly Solr from upstream. It's the same API.
OK. So clearly, we were looking at some of the new features in Solr 5.2.
Uh-huh.
OK. Is it easy to get Hue to interact with a version that's newer than something that's typically bundled with CDH?
Yeah, 5.2 is from last week. I mean, Solar 5.2,
sure.
So you can't do a newer. Most of the API didn't change. So I know, except the analytics facets, obviously, that are brand new, that can be disabled, actually. They are not on by default because it's kind of new. I think it goes back to the Solar of 2 years ago. It's still compatible.
Okay, thank you.
Sure, thanks. Thank you, everybody.